Assalamu alaikum and good morning, good afternoon, and welcome to all the respected participants to this webinar on the Management of Assessment Processes and Practices, MAP2. It is my pleasure to share my experience over the past 20 plus years of being part of assessment system in one way or another in various universities of Malaysia. Before we proceed, just let me tell you a bit about the presentation. On the right-hand side of your screen, there is a column in which some information will be provided as we proceed with the slides. These informations over there are not to be discussed, but this is sort of the motivators for you to, if anybody wants to do further study or want to know more in detail about those topics. The learning outcomes of this session include the ability to apply valid and reliable tools of assessment for various levels of course and types of assessment, manage the assessment process efficiently and effectively to maintain its integrity, and to maintain the quality control of assessment to the satisfaction of auditing bodies and the stakeholders. The presentation is divided into introduction, which will be followed by the processes and practices which are adapted during the three stages of assessment, that is pre-assessment, during assessment, and post-assessment, to close all the loops for validation purposes. O'Keel in 1939 made the observation that if we taught and examined less, the students will get more time to learn through self-study. However, with the exponential growth of knowledge and increasing demand from the stakeholders for more skillful doctors imbued with personal and professional qualities, it is a real dilemma to what to teach, what to learn, and what to examine. Hence the need for LOs for the curriculum, which bringing the concept of the outcome-based education, and to the purpose of assessment should be defined through those learning outcomes. An ideal assessment is the systemic gathering of information about students' progress leading in learning, which can be shown as evidence for internal and external validation purposes. What is the purpose of an assessment? Each university has their own specified LOs. According to those LOs, they develop their curriculum and they assess the students. But the main purpose of the assessment remains uniform for all the different universities, that is to judge the competency of the students in respect to their knowledge, skills, and attitudes, in measuring the improvement of the students, to give feedback to them, to give feedback to the teachers, and to give feedbacks to the parents to improve the learning of the students, to identify the students with difficulties, to award the students, to promote the students, or to do the remedial action on the students for their better performance. It also helps in the evaluation of the curriculum to improve the curriculum. The content can be updated and the learning outcomes can be adjusted accordingly, which usually occurs during the curriculum review, which normally should be done after every 5 years when a cycle of the curriculum is completed. It also helps in managing the standards for accountability, litigation, legislation, liability. We are living in a very dangerous world now. There are a lot of incidences in which the students, they go to the courts to sue for different reasons of the assessment. So our assessment should be foolproof enough so that we can avoid all those problems legal. The principle of an assessment, the purpose of the assessment should be specified, communicated, understood, and accepted by all the stakeholders. It is very important that this information is provided especially to the students as soon as they join the faculty or they join the university. The assessment should reflect student abilities, not the examiner's idiosyncrasies, their biases, or the language intricacies. All learning outcomes are clear and serve the stated purpose in progressive manner, assessed by the variety of methods, and all the learning outcomes should be assessed at any stage of the curriculum before graduation. So whenever we have specified the specific learning outcome, none of the learning outcomes should be left behind and it's not assessed. That is the PLOs. The instrument of assessment used are appropriate to the level of the students. The level of difficulty of assessment is appropriate for the examination for which they are used. The results are used ethically towards the stated purpose, and the regular feedback is provided to the students of their performance. It's just, again, this is a very important component of feedback of assessment, that the students should know how they performed and how they can improve in their learning. Ottawa Consensus in 2010 came up with the criteria of good assessments. They have identified 7 criteria. Of the 7 criteria, the first 5 criteria of validity, reproducibility or reliability, equivalence, feasibility, and acceptability is directly related to the assessment of the questions and their analysis. But the last 2, one, the educational effect of the assessment and the catalytic effect of this assessment, is very, very important, because it tends to motivate the students to prepare in such a way that it has an educational effect benefit, or it has a catalytic effect when the results and the feedback will motivate the students to learn better. Of those 5 criteria which were mentioned just now, the validity is the degree to which an instrument measures what it is supposed to measure. There is different types of validity. Content validity measures the specified content area in relation to domain, the knowledge, skills, and attitudes. The criterion validity is of 2 types. There is a concurrent validity and a predictive validity. Concurrent validity is when a new assessment tool comes in and you want to use that tool, you have to correlate its finding with that of the previously accepted tool so that you know whether both of them are giving the same sort of results. Or the predictive validity is certainty to which the test predicts the future performance of the students. For example, you have assessed the communication skills of the students and you have given them so much marks to the student that it means that you expect the students will be good communicator in the future. So that predictive validity will be assessed later on, whether the marking of that behavior was correctly done at that time or not. The construct validity, on the other hand, is the extent to which the test measure what it is supposed to assess, the idea, the concept, or the theory, and is determined by the evidence from all the other types of validity and by the experts. Last but not least is the face validity. Face validity practically is how the test is perceived by the students, by the teachers, or by the other experts around them. Usually when the students have completed their assessment, when they come out from the examination hall, generally we ask them the question, how was the test? And they will say it was very difficult, something was out of the course, or they have prepared it well, but they went blank out, all those. This is all the face validity, which does not have any significant statistical significance, but will tell you more about the student's perception of the test itself. The factors influencing the validity include the factors which are related to the learning outcomes if they are not clearly defined, or there is an inadequate time for testing the specific outcome, or there is an inappropriate instrument used for the desired outcome, or the level of difficulty of question is inappropriate for that learning outcome, or there are too few items to represent the full coverage of the course. The poorly constructed or related to the construction of the question is poorly constructed and or ambiguous items. There is a reading vocabulary or the sentence structure which are difficult. There is a detectable answer pattern. And one very important component which we normally don't give very, very much care about is the improper arrangement of the items. if we give the items to the students which are hodgepodge and which jump from one system to another system or one part of the body to another or one discipline to another discipline, the students are very confused in putting them at that point when they are already stressed out with the examination. So normally you have to arrange the question in such a way that, for example, they go this system wise, discipline wise, or the importance wise. So you have to arrange the question in different, in some sort of an order. The teaching methods sometimes don't tally with the assessment method, or unclear instructions are given to the students, or they are confused what actually they are supposed to do with that assessment. The third important factor again is the emotional stability of the and motivation and stress in the students, the teacher's personal liking, the cheating happening around them, or the scoring is not done properly, or the poor collation of the results because of the lack of time, or when the things are rushed too much. So the result there is has some sort of problems which are created because of improper entering of the marks. The second criteria is reliability. Reliability is the consistency in which an instrument is measuring what it is supposed to measure. It is of it is test to retest reliability, correlating the test score repeated on the same group of students after some time. So you have given a test to the students. For example, you are assessing their communication skills, and communication skills cannot be assessed in this way. The test retest reliability is correlating the test score repeated on the same group of students after some time. For example, the communication skills, because this test will test the trait which cannot change very quickly. So you don't expect the results to be very different from the previous ones. There is an equivalent form reliability, the consistency of scores between two different question sets of the same test, identical in number, structure, or difficulty. So one group is given one test, and another group is given another test, and then you compare the scores of the same class, different groups. The rater reliability is for subjective assessments. There is an inter-rater reliability when multiple examiners are used for same questions, or intra-rater reliability when same examiner is marking at different time. So the mood swings of the rater will affect the question marking the marking of that question. The split half reliability is when the questions are split into half. Usually the odd number questions are put on one side and the even number questions are put on another side, and then they are validated for whether the questions are reliable or not. This is usually done when you are assessing a single discipline or from a same module or same system of the body. The factors influencing reliability includes the environmental errors, student fatigue or hostility, the generalization error when there is an overall student impression is of the test is good or bad, the processing errors when we do miscalculation or we put incorrect marks or keys in the assessment, a very common problem which I will tell you something about it later on towards the end of the presentation. The classification error is the examiner's subjectivity in marking, their idiosyncrasies are over there, their biases are over there, or the marking bias errors where the weightage in the global rating scales, one judge may value one attribute more than the other, the rate of prejudice of personal liking and disliking for the student or for that specific method. The hollow effect is the bias of previous impression. The previous impression of the student was not good. So when the student you see in the examination hall, you already have made up your mind that this student is not going to perform good and cannot pass the examination. The leniency and stringency is the dove and hawk type of examiners. Some are too lenient and some are too very strict in giving the marks. The influence of the senior examiners on the junior examiners, if two of them are sitting together to assess a student, has a big influence on the junior examiners. The test administration errors, the outside noises, the room temperature, the readability of material, the comfortable seating, the seating arrangement, the duration of the test, et cetera, et cetera. There are so many factors which can influence the reliability of the assessment. The feasibility is another factor in terms of logistics, student number, how many student number can we deal with in one go, whether we have to do in two groups or when we are doing it two groups, how are we going to maintain the standards, the cost, the time, the human resources. A lot of factors will chip in this situation. The practicality is the student and staff time consumed for preparation, conduct, delivery, and management of assessment, and if it is sustainable. Usually, for example, we do the end of module examination after every 4 to 5 weeks. Can we combine the assessment of two modules to give one assessment only, so that the student and the staff time is utilized for other purposes. The authenticity is the degree of correspondence of a given test task to target task in real world situation. Whatever you are asking in the examination, does it relate to the real world, or these are rare or the trivial informations you are asking in the questions. The objectivity is the degree to which the human involvement in the scoring of the question is minimized. For example, we have the question marks by the optical reader, the model answers are produced, which are to be strictly followed. The marking schemes are given to the students. Double marking are done for some questions, especially the subjective type of question, and standardized viva voce is done. The generalizability is choose a mix of valid and reliable methods. Generally, the number of methods which are used in assessment in literature shows from 8 to 13 are used, but not all the 13s are used in the same examination. They are used at different stages at different level of the course. Acceptability is the defensibility, the set standards of an acceptable performance. When we use the marking schemes and all that, the review and adjust available test methods and take the feedbacks. The types of assessment are of three types: the formative or the for feedback. It is informal, ongoing, two-way communicative process between the teachers and the student, where the discussion regarding the strength, weakness, and opportunities are more prevalent to improve on the learning of the students. It is more descriptive and qualitative, not quantitative. It also helps in informal monitoring of the students' progress by incorporating it into the coursework in non-threatening way, leading to students' self-evaluation. It provides feedback to the students on the progress for reflection and self-assessment. And believe me, when we say that we are giving feedback to the students regularly, there was a study done by Cross et al. In Australia. And they found that over the period of 10 years, the students were not happy with the way they were given the feedback. Conducted by observing the practical work, the clinical abilities, appraising the projects, evaluating small group discussions, conducting unplanned tests, warm-up questions, or more commonly used nowadays because of COVID is the gamifications. The continuous assessment is of progress. It is a summative assessment at the end of the module or posting that contributes to professional or progression examination. Generally assesses attitude, small group sessions, seminars, and case presentation, written reports, case write-ups, and logbooks. It is done for the area not adequately accessible in the final assessment. Usually require long-term observation, for example, of attitude, behavior, and relationship with the colleagues and patients. It is derived from subject experts, supervisor, facilitators, mentor reports, and 360-degree assessments. It provides a more accurate and complete pictures of the learning level of understanding of the subject. The summative assessment is of competence, how well prepared the student is to go to the working world. It is the endpoint assessment, is formal, judgmental, numeric, and quantitative, conducted at the specific juncture of the course. Systematically, samples of entire content appropriate to the stage of the course, common and important clinical problems that the student will encounter in the workplace, and a wider base of knowledge, skills, and attitudes are assessed during these summative assessments. The assessment must be specific to each level being evaluated for knowledge or skills. The contribution of individual assessment and examination to the overall assessment must be communicated to the students. The students should know that which of the assessments which are done over the year will contribute in the continuous in the summative assessment as a part of continuous assessment. It is used to grade or promote the student. It is used to certify the competence achieved, to ensure the quality assurance for the accreditation authorities, and to determine the competencies of the students. The pre-assessment is the first stage before the assessment, how the assessment should be prepared for. Set the timeline. Planning and preparation should start at least 6 months prior to examination. And this becomes very difficult if there are two intakes in the university and you are all the time in the examination mode because you're preparing for the next batch as soon as the first batch is over. Appoint internal moderators for each activity. They are sometimes called as the method leaders or method leads. So whatever the terminology is used, you should appoint for each activity. All the papers are prepared in two sets, which are submitted to academic office 2 months prior to examination date. That is the protocol, which is generally recommended in Malaysian universities, but rarely followed. The academic office submits the final formatted and checked paper with model answers to examination department 1 month prior to exam date. This examination department can be the university's examination department, or in some places the faculties have their own examination department which deals only with the examination of the medical faculty, which makes the thing a bit more easier for the faculty to manage the assessment. Examination department is responsible for printing, confidentiality, and the security of the papers in strong room, and the accreditation bodies are very, very likely to visit those strong rooms to see the level of the security of the printing of the papers. The examination department handovers the question paper to the chief invigilator only on the day of the examination. And the transcripts are collected, counted, and handed over to the examination department members by chief invigilator before the students leave the hall. So practically what happens, that it has happened in cases when the answer scripts have gone missing. The students have appeared in the examination but have not submitted the examination the answer scripts to the invigilator. So what is the normal protocol is that because there is a chief invigilator and there are a number of invigilators which are appointed for a specific examination, the invigilators take the responsibility of a specific number of students. They collect the sheet from them, they count them, they see that all the sheets have the proper student metric number over there. And then they can give it to the chief invigilator, who recounts them, and then they are submitted to the chief to the examination department. When they are submitted to the examination department, the proper passing over of these documents takes place, and there are signatures which are taken. There are set standards and mechanism to ensure that these standards are pursued and attained all across all courses and programs. Assessment procedures and processes operate in a way that are just, reasonable, and consistent. The duration of the course is specified. This is 5 academic years plus 2 years all over Malaysia, because this is the criteria of the Malaysian Medical Council. However, the interpretation of this 5 academic years plus 2 years is left to the faculty. So in some places, the extra two years is divided into 1 year for the preclinical and 1 year for the clinical year. So if the students does not need utilize the extra year in the preclinical year, that extra year is canceled, and then they have left again with only one chance for the clinical year. So instead of 5 academic years, they are left with one extra year for the clinical year. So their course is not 7 years, they can go up to 6 years. The timely and accurate guidance about all the types of assessment, including assessment format, length and range of content, the marking schedules, and their weightage to overall grades is explicit and should be explained to the students. The criteria to sit for all examination, progression from one stage to another, is also communicated. The contribution of individual assessment and examinations to the overall assessment to be communicated, not just the description that this is how they are going to do it. So how much marks will be contributed from which part has to be told to the students. The policies on plagiarism, appeal to result, deferment of assessment, moderation are clear and they are known to students. The procedures and processes for standard setting should be explainable through the rationale behind the decisions made. They are defensible to assure the stakeholders about its validity, demonstrating good effort was put into setting those standards. They are stable and the standards don't vary from year to year. They are achieved by psychometric standard setting for the assessments using ENGOF, borderline group, or OFSI methods, identifying the borderline candidates using standard errors of measurement. These are all statistical methods for which the faculty do need a statistician to help them in finding all this information. The assessor should undertake the training and benchmarking exercises. There is a clear protocol and transparent arrangement in reaching constant evidence-based defensible decisions. The coordination is central because the course runs for 5 years, and during those 5 years, some of the learning outcomes are assessed in the earlier stage, and some of them are assessed in the later stage. So the arrangement should be such that the mapping of the assessment is done so that we know that which of the learning outcomes were assessed at which stage of the curriculum. The overall assessment strategy is documented in a clear and accessible manner with the concrete clearly allocated. Who is responsible for which part of the assessment should be assigned, and roles and responsibilities should be given to those people involved. Medical education ensures that examiners and assessors are appropriately selected, trained, supported, and appraised. The appointment of external examiners is to ensure benchmarking and good practices. The close collaboration between the University Examination Division and Office of Registrar for clarification of any issues of legal or regulatory nature is very important. Involvement of student at various juncture to set or disseminate information about various decision is important. So some students are involved in the management of the assessment, The processes for quality assurance to ensure that the standards are being set and maintained through mapping of the each assessment. There are a number of committees which are formed to achieve all these targets. The examination committee, examination moderation committee, vetting committee, academic office, faculty examination department, Viva Voce the committee, board of examiners, faculty committee, and least but not the last, the Senate committee. But there are a number of other committees which can be involved on temporary basis to manage the assessment. And last is the question bank committee, when the questions are finally parked under usually medical education unit. The tools of assessment are many according to the type of cognitive assessment or the type of assessment methods the university or the faculty is using. A list of assessment methods is provided on the right side of your screen. You can select a number of methods from there according to the availability of the resources and defensibility that the method you have selected is appropriately meant for the same purpose. The constructive alignment is very important. Coherence between assessment, teaching strategies, and intended learning outcome is a must. The four steps in designing the constructive alignment in curriculum is to state the intended learning outcome in the form of standards, create a learning material, use assessment tasks, and develop grading criteria or rubrics for judging the quality of student performance. The alignment between assessment delivery of the curriculum and the learning outcome must be systematically and regularly reviewed to ensure its effectiveness. And all the accreditating bodies emphasize this point. The errors in constructive alignment can be that the learning outcomes are not well constructed or not well informed to the students. Instructional material or the content does not correspond to outcomes. Here, I want to clarify one thing, that sometimes the question makers, they come with a question which is not part of the content, which is used for a specific learning outcome, but they claim over there that they want to ask this question because they have taught it in the class. teaching something in the class does not make it the learning outcome of the students. It does not mean that this will be assessed. These are sometimes the part of the hidden curriculum. So during the vetting of the question, it is very important that we make sure that those hidden components or the likings of the question makers does not affect the selection of the questions. The selection of the wrong teaching learning activities for specific learning outcome, inappropriate assessment strategies, inappropriate use of assessment tools, knowledge being assessed in skill-based question, example OSPEs, or attitudes being tested in knowledge-based question, example MCQs. Constructive alignment is plotted on a proforma, where the course learning outcomes are related with the program learning outcome, the teaching methods and the assessment method, called as the blueprinting. The blueprinting is the table of specification in a template used to define the content of a given test to ensure that the content validity by verifying that all content domains are assessed. For example, if you look at this table over there, this is one of the test of the module on reproduction on embryology. So you see that the lecture number is identified, the learning outcomes of that lecture has been identified, the type of questions have been identified, which type of questions will be asked from this lecture. So these all documents are produced as the examinations proceed, both for the formative and the summative type of assessments. This blueprint is discipline based. This is for one of the papers which was conducted, which has the components of the cardiovascular system and respiratory system. If you look over there, this blueprint was made for the end of module examination and the preclinical professional examination. There is a list of questions of the lectures which are given over there for each of the subjects. The number of questions from each subject for MCQs are calculated according to their contribution. The number 25, which is given at the end total, is the maximum number of questions, because this paper consists of 50 questions and the 25 goes to CVS and 25 goes to the respiratory system, because they have almost the equal number of the teaching learning sessions. The table of specification can be content-based, in which you plot all the teaching learning methods for each of the disciplines, including the interdisciplinary seminars or the integrated teaching learning methods like PBLs, and see that how we are assessing those contents in different assessments, end of module or the professional examination. Because two sets are produced for the professional examination, the questions are distributed between the two sets. That doesn't mean that they will be identical from the content point of view, that if you're asking question, for example, from the anatomy of heart and pericardium in one set, it will be the same question or from the same lecture. No, it will be from the anatomy from different lectures, so that the holistic coverage of all the contents can be made over there. You see over here that this is the physiology lectures, and you will see the distribution that there is no sessions which have been missed in assessment over the time from end of module examination to the final professional examination. This is the specification for the clinical years, which was done according to the Bloom's taxonomy from C1 to C5 levels, the multiple true false question, best answer question, or the extended matching questions. The question numbers are given, the level of the question is also projected in this blueprint. Then the blueprint can be of the clinical competence. The student should be able to do that in a simulation, or do it under direct supervision, or can do it under the indirect supervision. So the skills are jotted down with the description how that should be done, and the level of competencies are identified. The vetting process is very hectic, very tedious, very fiery, very emotional in all the universities I have experienced with. In some universities, it has 2 tiers. In some universities, it goes through 3 tiers. But the discipline level vetting and the faculty level vetting is a must. At the discipline level vetting, the questions are under the control of the head of the discipline, while in the faculty level, all the head of the disciplines become the part of the member of this committee, which is headed by the medical education coordinator, and the questions are vetted again for their validity and reliability. The question vetting process is of reviewing and evaluating question items according to the specific criteria with the intention to detect flaws and to edit them accordingly to improve their quality. Believe me, when the questions are prepared by the subject expert, what they intend to ask in that question, when that question comes to the vetting committee, the other head of the departments have a very different meaning of that questions. So this vetting process practically sorts out all those problems so that when the question goes to the students, they know exactly what they will be assessed on. They are assessed on. The vetting committee review the items to ensure content validity, technical accuracy, level of test items, accreditation requirement, and the question should be free of any flaws. For professional examination, 2 sets are submitted to the examination department of same standard. Supposedly, that is what we aim for. 1 set is selected for final and other for the supplementary examination by the examination department. And most of the time, the faculty does not know which set will be appearing in the examination because that is shown only when the examination begins and the examination department bring those questions in their strong boxes. During assessment, there are specific rules and regulations. Each student has to sit on his own designated table. They cannot change their seating arrangement. The question papers and answer sheets are distributed according to the table number before the beginning of the examination. The students should report 15 minutes before the beginning of the exam. The students should carry their ID cards and examination registration slip, which they will put on the table on the right-hand corner as soon as they take their seat. Each examination must be taken as a whole. You cannot say that this time I'm going to sit for the written examination and the next sitting I'm going to sit for the practical examination. It is not allowed. The identity of student is biometric number. Nobody is allowed to write their name on the answer scripts. The instruction for each paper is read to the students during all examination. It is repeated so many times. Most of the time, the students have already memorized the instructions, but still it is the legal binding that they should be read to the students. The students are not allowed to bring any prohibited material like paper, mobile phones, written material in the examination. In the examination hall. The students barred from the examination is considered failed. The students are not allowed to leave the hall before completion of the designated time. I've told you that what process takes place regarding the collection of the answer sheets. The external examiners are appointed for the professional examinations only. 2 to 3 external examiners are generally appointed for each professional examination representing the major specialties. For the clinical years, the major specialties are considered medicine, surgery, gynecology, and pediatrics. For the preclinical years, any discipline, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, pathology, microbiology, anybody can be invited for that. The criteria for selection of those external examiners should be clear and known to the staff members. Their qualification, their interest, all that matters in their appointment. The staff members are allowed to suggest the name, but the conflict of interest is to be avoided. The appointment of an external examiner usually is for 2 years. It fulfills the requirement in relation to expertise and experience in design and delivery of assessment. This is the requirement of the GMC. It's not being followed in Malaysia that the people who are appointed at the external examiner should have a know-how or experience in the design and delivery of assessment. And they should guide the faculty in which they are acting as an external examiner in evaluating their assessment system and making it better. The duties and powers of the external examiner should be clearly set up and they should contribute to the review and development of the assessment strategies. Okay, the last part of this is the post-assessment, the marking of the papers. Examiner must be trained to carry out their role and to apply it to medical school assessment criteria consistently. All the model answers are vetted along with the questions. The guidelines for marking should be thoroughly worked out and provided to each examiner. All essay type questions with model answers are double marked to improve the reliability. The blind marking is done by two examiners. Any difference in marking of 20% or above requires discussion among the two examiners to reach a consensus. Any difference of marking of less than 20% marks required out averaging the marks. The student reserves the right for remarking of paper by paying an amount of fee. The clear marking scheme providing adequate time to examiners for marking increases reliability. This is one sticky area in the assessment when the usually the marking of the papers is rushed because the external examiners are coming from different from different cities or even from different country, and it increases the cost burden on the faculty if they are there for a longer period of time. And for that purpose, because they have to be there till the exam board meeting, so practically sometimes the examiners are overstretched in the marking of the papers. The OMR sheets which are given for the objective type of question should be double checked. There are issues with the master sheet. The student answer sheet is used as a master sheet. First of all, there is no document which is labeled as a master sheet. So sometimes it causes confusion. Sometimes there is an incomplete or a wrong information given on the master sheet, and you wouldn't know which year, which examination is this for. The mixing up of the master sheet due to wrong labeling, example, PBM for PM. For the people who are not aware of what is PBM, is the psychological and behavioral medicine, and PAM is the pediatric and adolescent medicine. So difference of A and B. This is one sample of the master sheet which was submitted. It says year 3 medicine. Which group, which year is not specified. So when you look back at this sheet, you would never know which examination it was. The wrong answers keys makes the result unreliable. You will see that the areas marked over here as in circles, they have either there is no darkening of the correct answer, or the darkening is not complete, or it is over marked, and I think probably the pen is used to mark it. Probably the examiner does not have at that time the pencil to use it. Specific pencils are used for this purpose. If you do this sort of mistake, what will happen is that you will see that this type of pattern will be visible on the OMR report. If there are dashes mean that those questions have not been marked properly and the optical reader is not reading them. And when the optical reader is not reading them, you will see that for those areas, the students will be getting 0 marks. Whether they have done it correct or incorrect, in both situations, they will get 0 marks. And these 0 marks will also relate to, because they've got 0 marks over there and they have given the wrong answer. 46, for example, in the first question, if you look at the B8C, the 46 students, we have not done it correctly. Only the 0 student has done it correctly. That means there will be a negative marking of those 46 students as well. So they will be losing half a mark for each of their wrong answers as well. All because of the fault of the wrong master sheet filling. Wrong answer keys sometimes are put in the master sheet. For example, the question 5 and 6 were D and C, but in the master sheet they appear as C and D, and that you will see that has resulted in number of students who should have passed as failing those assessment failing that question because of the wrong answers. There are rubrics which are developed for a number of assessments, usually when the assessment is of attitude, reflection, professionalism, ethics, the rubrics are there. Or for the long case and short case, there are the marking sheets which are developed, and marking sheets are also developed for the OSP examinations. The tabulation of the result goes by if the most of us are following the criterion based assessment, in which the criteria is set, the D's, C's, and the B's in the A's. accordingly they are marked with that. In most of the places, however, the marks are tabulated in the form of numerics, and then they are converted into the grades later on. This is the normal grading marking scheme with a slight difference here and there. This is generally followed in whole of the Malaysia. Moderation of the result is one more activity which is done after those assessment, the result has been prepared, in which the students who are at the borderline, they are assessed whether they can be moderated or the results can be modified for those students. Absence, illness, or other attenuating circumstances is not the reason for a line student to graduate without demonstrating the achievement of outcomes. So it is very important that generally the outcomes students should be able to demonstrate, and if they are not able to demonstrate that outcomes for whatever reason, they cannot be passed. Taking appropriate consideration of the justifiable circumstances without compromising the patient safety or the outcomes required of graduate. Sometimes it can happen that if the student was not able to complete an assessment or complete an examination, the moderation committee has the power to nullify that result for the student and think that this student has not appeared in that assessment. So it is not considered as one attempt. And that is extra help to the students in which they can appear without losing one chance. Although adjustment cannot be made to the competence standards, reasonable adjustment can be made to enable a disabled person to meet the competency standards by the Senate. Senate approves those special arrangements if we have a disabled student. The feedback to students using clinical logbooks, the personal profiles and examination results help students to identify strengths and weaknesses, which are managed at the phase level. This is something which is introduced by me. I take the credit of it. The student tracking system in almost all the universities in which I have contributed so far. This is actually the tracking of the students' progress in each module or each test, and to correlate it with the class average and see how the students are performing. This has helped us to identify the students who are having difficulties earlier on. We put the red flag on them, and then we ask the mentors to take good care of them and see what is the problem with those students and how those students can be assisted, and to give the remedial to those students if the remedial classes are required. This is again for the year two. When we are looking at the student's performance, we also look at the class average. And if the class average is 51, for example, for this test on CVS, this is the end of module assessment. So 51 means that the whole class is on an average at the brink of failing the examination. So we have to look at the paper and see whether the assessment, the type of questions and the level of question was at par to the student's requirement or not. So this has helped us a lot in doing the moderation of the students at the end of the assessments, and in helping the students by giving them the proper feedback at a different level. This is the student tracking for the final year, the clinical years. The beauty of this form is that it traces the student performance over the three clinical years, year three, year four, and year five. And you can gauge from there how the student has been performing over the time. And again, the same criteria is used that if the students are not performing well, you can identify those students and do some remedial action as quickly as possible so that the students are able to graduate on time. The student tracking system also has this one component in which you can put the exact marks of the student in different modules or in the different elements. And the gray areas over here actually shows that these are the weak areas of the student. So for this student, for example, you will see that the student has been consistently weak in the true false type of questions and in the SEQs question, but they have been doing, the student has been doing pretty well in the OSPI questions. So the mentors are informed in that case, the mentor or a new mentor is appointed. So there will be two mentors who will be helping this student in overcoming these problems before the professional examination is conducted. Student feedback is taken after each module. That feedback analysis is also very important to gauge the student understanding of the different subjects. That feedback is both in the graph forms as well as the comments of the student. And each and every comment of the student is given weightage to and is analyzed, and the remedial actions are taken as and when required. The item analysis is another method of gauging the type of the items which we are used to see whether the questions have been of the standard or not. It is the student's response to individual test item in order to assess the quality of those items and to assess the test as a whole. Information gathered about item difficulty, discrimination, power of item, and an objectivity could be used to improve the item further before these questions are stored in the question bank. The item analysis provide information about faulty items and can provide information about student misconceptions and topics that need additional work. Improving the item, which will be used again through appropriate revision to reduce technical defects and the factors causing them. The item analysis, mainly the things which are done mostly in the universities is the difficulty and the discrimination index. The difficulty index of a question is actually the number of students with the correct answer. It's the percentage of the student actually with the correct answer from the total number of the students. The range of the responses is 0% to 100% or 0 to 1. Usually it is being calculated in percentage. The higher this percentage, the easier the item. So this is a sort of a misnomer which is used as a difficulty index. Practically, it is the easy index of the question. The criteria to classify the specific item according to its index of difficulty is very difficult. 0 to 29% of students are able to do it. Difficulty is 30 to 49. Easy is to 50 to 89, and very easy is when 90 to 100% of the students are able to do those questions. This was identified by Abel and Crispy in 1986. However, the universities can modify these things. And for example, in one of the universities, the question instead of in four categories were transformed into three categories: difficult, moderate, and easy. We don't want to have easy and very easy. That reflects bad on the type of question that probably we are having the examination, which is very easy. If the question item comes out to be too easy, then probably we have selected the weak choices. There is a low level of understanding. The question is of low level of understanding, or it is below the level of student being examined. If none of these reasons is identified and the item touches the important area, still we can use this question in the future. Similarly, if the item is too difficult, maybe the wrong answer key has been entered. There are more than one answers. It's a rare or a trivial area of knowledge which is assessed, or it is a faulty item. If none of this reason is found and the item tests an important area, again, this question will be accepted as it is. Discrimination index, on the other hand, is the index of item, the degree to which an item discriminates between student of high and low achievements. To calculate the high or low achievements, we have the H students with correct answer minus the L students with the incorrect answer over the total number of high or low. How do we determine the high and low? Is we take the overall results and we take 25%, 27%, 30%, or 33%, depending upon the universities. They can select any of these average. So the percentage for the higher is the higher, 27%. And the lower 27% will be the low achievers. So the result is compared between these two, and how many of those students in the high are giving the correct answer and how many students in the low are giving the correct answer over the total number of high and low, which is the same as for the high or the low. The answer ranges from -1 to 1. The components of this are very poor items, marginal item, good items, and very good items. The range has been identified. However, again, there is some adjustment done, and the items in most of the universities in Malaysia will be negative, poor, good, or very poor. Okay, the negative items are usually very sticky and reflect bad on the assessment. That means that the good students are not able to answer those questions correct, while the poor items range from 0 to 1.5 and the good between 0.2 to 3.9 and very good is more than 0.4. The low discrimination item answered correctly or incorrectly by more than 85% students okay. have markedly reduced discrimination. Too easy or too difficult items. These are too easy or too difficult items. Assessing trivial facts with low level of understanding or the very basic facts. A very good item may have low discrimination if all have learned what they were supposed to. That is the concept which has been highly emphasized during the sessions. So we have to see that the student which is not showing a very good discrimination, the question which is not showing a very good discrimination can still be a good question because it is assessing the must know area of or a very important or very life-saving part of the assessment. Usually these type of questions are not included in the professional examination but at the lower level examinations. The high discrimination means that item can discriminate students who have learned from those who have not, hence the better item, they are the better items. Index is not determined by the content alone, but also by the students who have attempted them. So sometimes you have the good lot of students who have learned it, so the discrimination will be more for those questions, for those items. The negative discrimination, however, means that the weak students are getting the item correct. The wrong key has been entered, the statement are ambiguous, or the question which is asked is currently under investigation or is a research topic. Now, this is one example over here. If you see at this graph, please concentrate on this box over there. There were 42 correct answers, but 24 were incorrect and 8 were unanswered. 24 plus 8 makes it 32. So 42 students did it correct and 32 were wrong, but the discrimination which is coming over here is negative. Means that the students who were not good were answering this question right, and that causes the difficulty of the question to be increased. It is 57%, only 56% of the students have done it correct. By looking at the difficulty index, it is a good question, but if you look at the discrimination index, it is poorly discriminating the students, the good from the bad one. So you have to thoroughly look at and investigate at this question. The second is the 36 were correct, but 33 plus 5 is more than 36 is 33 plus 5 is 38. So it's equal. So you will see that it has a good discrimination and it has a good difficulty. 0.55 and 48.68. It is slightly on a more difficult side and slightly is because of that it is more discriminatory. Now look at this question, 1C component of this question. The 33 students did it incorrect and 20 students did not answer it. So technically from the 74 students, 30 plus 20 is 53 students did not answer the question or they did answer it incorrect. Only 21 student did it correctly. And the next item is that 74 students did it correctly and none of them has done it incorrectly. If you look at the analysis of these questions, there is no discrimination because either most of the students have done it wrong or all of the students have done it right. So there is no discrimination. The first one has made the question a bit more difficult because many students were not able to do it. Well, the second one, the 100% of the questions, 100% of the students were able to answer it. That means that these questions need to be thoroughly reviewed because four of these items have some sort of flaws. The last one, IE of this question, 64 done it correct, 9 plus 1, 10 it incorrect. But again, there is a negative discrimination in this question. The difficulty index is not bad, but the discrimination index is even worse than the item 1A. Item 1A was 0.2. In one of my previous slides, I have given how to calculate the discrimination index. Please go through it. It will be fun for you to follow that. In the second question, all the questions have the difficulty index of more than 70. So that means that overall this question was very easy for the students. Lastly, the last slide is on the question bank. Each staff department faculty can develop their own question bank by collecting the questions used in different assessment. After scrutinizing them through item analysis, this can also include records of when these questions were previously used. There are softwares also available in which you can store this question, bank those questions. But it is an expensive gadget, so usually the only the rich universities can use them. The question bank can be created for all type of question that are parked at medical education unit to support staff, if support staff is adequate, because it is quite a tedious process to put those question in different under different disciplines, different lectures, and all that. The commercial publisher, as part of textbook adaptation agreement, provide questions on CD-ROMs within the textbooks. Those questions can be used, but those questions cannot be used for the assessment purpose, but for the student formative assessment or student self-assessment. The multiple online resources are available free. It gives you a load of questions are available over there as part of self-assessment again, because those are available and you guide the students towards those resources. It is unfair to ask those questions in the examinations. I think that is, or the students can develop, yeah, this is very important. Students develop their own question banks and they sell those question banks, those questions as well. So they are earning some money over there. That's all from me. Thank you very much for your kind listening.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Dr. Danish. May I ask a question, please?
Hello. Hello.
How to avoid assessment in the same content of any discipline in the different modalities of assessment? Any software to overcome this overlap? It seems to occur often. Student is given a long case of jaundice. OSCE is on the interpretation of liver function test, exactly. This, I'm not aware of any software which is available for that, but usually this sort of problems are overcome when we do the blueprinting and during the vetting of the questions. The questions regarding formative assessment, can formative assessment be marked, quiz, discussion, etc., and the marks are included in internal assessment and communicated to the student as well? Are continuously assessed throughout? Yes, you can mark those questions and give the feedback to the students, but these marks are not used for any type of any other purpose other than giving feedback to the students in the future. How to decide exam duration, total of each assessment tool? For example, the credit hour is 3 credit hours. Usually the each assessment has been identified and the number of questions for each assessment type have been worked out, and this is as a principal policy. This depends on the number of credit hours for each module or each posting cumulatively, and then dividing the questions with the different disciplines over there. But one thing which is very important is that you should cover all the learning outcomes which are identified for the assessment. For example, you can have more questions which are objective type, which will do the wider coverage of the curriculum. I've seen universities in which they give only 60 questions as MCQs. There are universities which give 50 questions for each paper over there. So you have more than 200 questions through which the students have been assessed. It depends upon the resources of the faculty, the resources of the university. There is no fixed criteria on the number of questions that can be asked. But make sure that you are resourceful enough and it does not burn out the students while sitting in the assessment process. how to design, okay, is vetting and moderation same thing? No. The vetting of the question is to make the question reliable, to make the question valid, to see whether they're valid and reliable, to see whether there are no errors in the questions, and the formatting of the question is correct. While the moderation occurs after the assessment, when you look at those the results of the student and see whether the students who are borderline can be helped in some way to improve their results, if they are able to do all the necessary competencies which are identified for them, the learning outcomes they have already completed, or they have a valid reason for not being able to sit for the assessment. You can provide them with the alternate methods help them in sitting for the exam next time. By, for example, I've told you that you can cancel the previous result of the student and say that this is not taken as a one chance which you have missed. Moderation is also done to see the students whether they will be going for the distinction viva, whether they can be in their grades. For example, then. Distinction for the distinction students. Any other question?
Dr. Danish has raised her hand. Can you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Yes, sir. I had posted my question as well. How to decide about the permissible number of attempts for a particular?
We can't hear you.
How to decide about the permissible number of attempts for the students? Generally, this is the decision which is done by the accreditating bodies or the Malaysian Medical Council, or in Pakistan, probably the PMDC has to decide what are the number of attempts they can take. I know in Pakistan you can have unlimited number of attempts or something like that, but in Malaysia it is a 5 years course plus 2 years extra. Of those 2 year extra, you can have 1 year for the preclinical extra. So that preclinical, instead of 2 years, a student can complete in 3 years. A student cannot repeat any more than twice. So if they have already done, for example, they have repeated the first year and they have completed their quota of two attempts in first year, they fail in the second year, then they are out of the course. They cannot continue with the course. In the clinical years, again, you have 1 year extra, but some universities interpret it differently. They say that you can have these 2 years anytime in the course. The Malaysian Medical Council is silent on this thing, how to interpret it. Mm-hmm. But the number of attempts is increased if the university has double intake, so that student can sit after 6 months with the next batch, and then after a few months with the next batch. So the number of attempts for those students is increased, but the duration, the academic session of 1 year, that is not increased.
There's a question: if all the students answer a question, should that question answer correctly, should that question be used, or is it too easy?
100% student answering the question, it is an easy question. But then you have to scrutinize that question, you have to see that whether this question is testing a very, very important component of the course, which if the student is not able to answer, probably you will fail that question, fail that student. So in that case, you can keep those questions. But if you're assessing the trivial facts or something like that, a basic knowledge question, which is low level question, then you may not use that question later on in any assessment.
How can we make the assessment reliable and valid in present COVID? That's a different question here.
The question vetting process can still be conducted. Your level of questions can still be maintained. It's only that how you examine the student, that is the only part which becomes different in the COVID situation. Mm-hmm. So the validity of the question will still be there. The reliability, if you're using the foolproof method of doing the question, will still be there. But yeah, there will be some compromise at some places. For example, mm-hmm. for assessing the skills of the students, or whether the students are cheating or not. These some areas might be compromised.
Any last question?
Yeah, please.
Great. Thank you very much, Dr. Ruksana, for your educative session.
Thank you very much, sir.
In assessment, some of the standard setting benchmarks may be compromised, isn't it?
When you are doing the standard setting, prof, you are practically benchmarking the questions.
Yes.
Sometimes you have to do statistical analysis of those questions to find out whether those questions were really reliable or not. So in that case, probably sometimes you have to remove this question if the reliability of this question is not there. But a standard setting is usually considered as a good method to come to find out about the, it's a bit of a tedious process, and it's a lengthy process to benchmark the questions, but it is generally is effective method.
Thank you.
Excuse me, Dr. Ruksana, may I ask a question, please?
Yes, please, Paul.
Every examination contains some number of items which address a must-know component of the course content. Mm-hmm. But the number of such questions may be small, and the student may still get through even if he does not even attempt these questions. How to overcome this problem, please?
Prof, my concept of must-know is that all the questions should be must-know. It is the level of question which is important. So the must know, if the question is of the lower level, they should be assessed in the class test or in the formative assessments. But the questions which come for the form with the summative assessment, they should be of a higher level of Bloom's taxonomy, which has been identified with the verbs which are used in the learning outcomes. So whenever we are selecting the different verbs for the learning outcomes, that is the level of question we want the student to have. So if we are asking too much of the trivial type of questions, definitely the examination will not be considered as a very reliable way of assessing the students' competencies or their knowledge, because you are assessing only doing the superficial scratching. So normally when we are vetting the questions, we identify that say some percentage of questions should be from the must know, from the lower level, that is C1 or C2, and the number of questions more from will be from the C3 or C4. Usually this is decided by the faculty. So normally, for example, in our case, about 20% of the questions can be of the C1, C2 level, but the remaining questions should be of the analysis and the explanation of the phenomena.
Yes, Dr. Nigat raised her hand.
Assalamualaikum, Dr. Ruksana. I'm Dr. Nigat from Lahore Medical Dental College. I'm working as assistant professor in DME. My question is what do you do for criteria for distinction students? Because you see, before in our times, the theory paper used to be with the examiners. They would know what the student had done in the theory. But now that is not the case. They only have students for the Viva, OSPI, and other tools. So we do talk about the borderline students, but no one talks about the distinction students. So what criteria should be for them now?
Okay, the general criteria...
I'm sorry to interrupt. There are students who lose a distinction with 1 mark. You know, we have 2 ends. 1 mark, a student could fail, and 1 mark, a student could lose a distinction. So kindly elaborate on that. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Dr. Nigat, what is happening over here in Malaysia is that we use those gradings. Any student who have scored more than 80% marks in the examination Any student who has scored more than 80% marks in the assessment overall, above 80% will get straight away distinction. They don't have to go for the Viva. The student who have scored between 75 to 80% marks, they will be called for the Viva. And if they have secured the distinction, which will be subject based or which can be overall, because the number of examiners over there will be assessing them, so they can give them the distinction. For example, you have a distinction in medicine and surgery, but you don't have any distinction in pediatrics or gynae. Usually the four major subjects are assessed. Some questions they can ask from the other subjects also, but usually the VIVAs are standardized. In that case, the student might be given a distinction in a subject or can be given a distinction overall, but the marks are not increased. So we will say that the student has secured, say, 78% marks, but distinction in these subjects or overall distinction. Is it clear? So the during the moderation, the moderation also, it is decided that if the student has not secured, say, we say that from 75% to 80% marks is the students are called for distinction. If the student has secured 74% marks, for example, 74 point something percent marks, and we look at their previous results, those graphs of that student, and the graph tells that the student has been performing pretty well, so those students are also called for the distinction viva. It is up to the moderation committee to call those students, but usually we take the consent of the external examiners for that. Okay. Similarly, if the student is borderline failing, those students are also called for the viva, whether they should be passed or not. So there, it has happened sometimes that the student has passed by 51% marks, but is not given the pass mark because during the viva they thought that the performance of the student was very poor. Sorry, Dr. Nigat, has it answered it?
I would say that works very well, but in our situation, mm-hmm. Where the examiners do not have the theory marks of the students, because here this is not the system that if a student has, say, taken 84 or above 80% marks in theory, they will be given distinction. The student still has to go for VIVAs like any other normal student. And even then, if the internal doesn't point out, or usually the student's internal assessment in most colleges is with the external and internal. So do you think if this system... Another question is that when you have an internal assessment of a student, and obviously if the student has been excelling the whole year, does that bring a bias to giving a distinction? Because they don't know if the student has achieved the 80% mark or 85, whatever, for distinction in theory marks. And in VIVA, if the internal assessment is there, the student has been excelling the whole year. And obviously the distinction question, do you believe should be way above and beyond the other students, or they just ask a few questions and they know this student performed very well and they should get a distinction on, say, the internal assessment or on one or two questions that they asked? Do you think that's enough to give distinction to a student? Yeah. Are we giving too many distinctions to students?
No, sometimes it happens that we give there are many students. It depends upon on that intake. Sometimes there are a number of students who are appearing for the distinction, and sometimes there is one or two students who appear for the distinction. Now, Dr. Nigat, the situation is like that we don't give distinction on the theory paper alone. We give the distinction overall. The theory and the practical marks, they are all added, and if those marks comes more than 80%. They are straight away given distinction, overall distinction, or if they are their marks are between 75% to 80%, that is they are getting A grades. In that case, they are called for the viva. The questions are standardized. They are slightly above the level of the students because they are going for an extra mile to get the distinction. So they will not be the same level questions which were asked in the examination, but of a higher level than that one, because then we think that the students are beyond the average students, so they should be getting the distinction. Your second question is that how many distinctions we can give. It depends upon the student's performance. Sometimes we have to do the distinction viva for a very lengthy time, and the external examiners, mind you, are the people who are actually assessing the students for the distinction viva. The internal examiners are not the part of that committee which assesses the students for distinction viva. So We are not making them biased by showing them the previous results or anything like that. They just have the result of the final examination only with them.
Right.
Thank you very much. That was very elaborate. Thank you for your time.
And thank you. Thank you.
Elaborate on tracking system.
Oh, the tracking system is a simple method. It is nothing technical. What happens is that for each student, we make a graph. It is usually on the PowerPoint. I don't use the Excel because in Excel, the every time the graph will change, and then you have to create another PowerPoint presentation for that. The students' marks are entered in that for each module or each posting, and the average of the class is calculated. So the students are assessed with the average of the class and see whether the students are performing well. And if you look at those graphs, you will see that after, say, the students are going up and down means the students' performance is shaky. So those are the students which need early intervention. And through this method and through providing remedial to these students, we have been able to make many of the students who could have left the course or could have not been able to perform well, they did well in the examination because they were given extra attention, they were given extra exercises to do, they faced two mentors. One mentor will deal with their psychological and behavioral and all those aspects, the other will guide them more towards the teachers. The teachers played a very, very vital role in that one, that they took extra classes after hours as well, or they mentored those kids psychologically as well. So practically it was a win-win situation on both sides because most of our experience is with the private universities, and in private universities, you know, you don't want to lose any student in the middle. So practically, if the student is not performing well, it is the responsibility of the faculty to bring the standard of those students, to make them motivate, to make them do the things. And mind you, in the private universities, the students which are coming are not all of them are the rich people children. They are coming from quite poor families, and sometimes it has happened that the students have been working after hours. In different restaurants or in the shopping plazas, and that is why they were not able to give enough time for their studies. So we need to know the reasons behind them, and then to counsel them and provide them with the help or try to solve some of their problems so that they can perform well in their academics.
Next is elaborate the role of student in assessment management.
In the different type of assessment which have been conducted, when the students give the feedback, you give them are given the feedback, they will give you their feedback about the question types. After the examination, you talk to them about each question and each item separately, not for the summative examination, but mostly for the formative assessment. You inform the students about the rules and regulation, and the students will sometimes give you suggestion that they want to have a different rule and regulation for that purpose, which will be discussed by the examination committee, and that can be approved or disapproved. The student representation in there in some of those decision-making committees in which the students come, and they see how the process of student assessment is developed, and they can give their feedback. For example, they can tell you how much time the student needs for preparation of the examination. Usually we think that you can take the examination soon after the module is over. Sometimes they will suggest you differently. So they will give you the student's perspective of the assessment like we involve the students in the curriculum development, so we involve the students in the assessment development processes, but not obviously not in the question vetting sessions or those type of sensitive areas.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much, everybody. We are coming to the end of our session, and just two more slides to share. At the end, one is the The next webinar is on competency-based medical education, and it would be in the new year on 24th of January. And I hope to see you all in that webinar as well. And the final one, our usual request of charity drive. We appeal to each participant who joined in this session to donate $1 or equivalent amount, whatever is in your local currency, to any individual, deserving individual in your neighborhood or any public welfare organization in your community. With that, I thank all of you, everyone, for your support and interest, and inshallah, we'll see you soon again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.